So I'm Chris. Most people, I think, know me now, but for those who don't, I work at Three-Sided Cube. I'm a PHP developer. I recently, as in last week, gave a talk at a UK conference for PHP, which was really cool. So I put this talk together a while ago to try and give a bit of advice that I've picked up. So it's not all just from me, but stuff I picked up as part of my experience of getting into doing talks and learning how to do them. And I basically just tried to collect it all into one place. And originally I was going to write a blog post on this, but I thought, actually, if I'm going to really preach about stuff about kind of giving good talks, then surely the best way to do that is to do a talk about it. So this is my very meta talk. To start off, your first slide, like this one, will be looked at longer than any other slide. Here I've got some bits and pieces that I've just chosen to make this up, but they're all there really for a reason, apart from maybe the background image, but just makes it look a bit pretty. This is a new thing I've started doing, which is putting a link to the slides. So if any of you actually want to pull up on your mobile phone now, you could follow along with the slides. People seem to like that at conferences, especially where sometimes you're stuck behind a pillar or something, or someone in front of you is very tall and you can't see the screen very well. Everyone can give a talk, and I mean that. Absolutely everyone can give a talk. 2 years ago, I'd never done a talk at all. Now people can't shut me up. So as I say, I've spoken at PHP UK last week. There's about 100 people there. If you'd asked me 2 years ago whether I'd be doing that, I would just, be serious. I wouldn't have believed you. Getting into doing talks is probably the best thing I've ever done, because it's made me much more confident as a person, not just for standing up here and talking to a group of people, but just having conversations at work, getting my voice heard. Used to be very shy, used to talk very quietly and not get listened to very much. So it's been an amazing thing to do. And you don't need to be perfect at it first time. So there's a quote from Jake the Dog from Adventure Time, and this is something that I always take with me, because it's not a bad thing to not be good at something. It's just the first step at getting sort of good at it. So find a local youth group like this one and practice speaking. People will appreciate you spending the time in putting something together, standing up and giving it. And I've never had anyone give any sort of anything negative towards me for getting up and doing it. Everyone always seems to be very appreciative. You can take inspiration from lots of different places. For example, Ross Tuck was a speaker at Redevelop when they did the first Redevelop, which is a local conference in the area. Taking a hiatus this year, unfortunately. But I really liked his speaking style. I liked the way he put slides together and the way he presented himself. And I tried to emulate that. I'm nowhere near on his level, but it gave me some ideas of maybe how I want to present things. Another good one is comedians. So again, I'm not here to be funny, but by watching comedians, you pick up things of the way their demeanor and the way they present things. And most importantly, timing is an interesting one that comedians are very good at. So as I say, you can take a lot of inspiration just by watching people talk. So it's okay to pick a subject you don't know lots about. In fact, this is the best reason to do a talk is to pick something you know a little bit about, but you wish you really understood the in-depths of. And then say to someone like these guys or another local youth group, hey, I want to do a talk on that. And what they'll do is you'll put your name down and say, cool, we've got you penned in now. You're going to do a talk, and here's your deadline of when you're going to give it. And that is the best motivator that you can have to actually really learn something inside out. Because if you don't, then your talk is going to be okay, but the more you put into it, the better your talk is going to be. And then afterwards, you'll realize how much you've just learned from that process that you wouldn't have otherwise. My tip here, though, is don't pick subjects that you know absolutely zero about, because that will show. Tell your side of the story. So this talk is very opinionated. It's what worked well for me. And that's the same for your talk. So if someone disagrees with something in your talk, that's not a fault of your talk. It's just an opportunity for a discussion. And that's ultimately why we're doing this. We're here to share knowledge. People want to hear what you have to say about it. So when speaking, make it personal. So much of your talk can be found in books. People have come to see your take on it and how you feel about it. So using words like this is a really good way to do that. Again, you're allowed to be opinionated. In fact, it's generally preferred. I've watched a lot of talks where people sit very much on the fence with things, and I've kind of switched off because I'm like, well, what you're talking about is interesting, but I don't really feel you're selling it to me. So I'd actually rather have someone be a bit controversial and then go and talk to them about it afterwards. Use your hands. So it's fine to gesticulate. That's something that's always people are quite worried about when they get up and talk in front of a lot of people. It's kind of like, what do I do with my hands? I like holding a clicker, that helps. But it's fine to use your hands to help add some animation. If you use them too much though, if you're trying to like describe something like this goes inside this with this, then maybe that's a point that you should build a slide to show what you're trying to describe there. But yeah, gesticulation is my favorite word. And someone who's really great at that, not the first time you've seen him tonight. Now, the thing is, I put this in before the election, actually. I don't like this man at all. But say what you like about him, it works for him. It gets people's attention, and he's very good at interrupting people as well with his hands, getting their attention. Movement, so move around if you want to, if you don't like standing still. Particularly with if you've got a clicker, it's very freeing. You can still change your slides and stuff, and you can walk around. It's also absolutely fine to stay completely still. The only thing I would suggest is try not to do any repetitive movements, like rocking back and forth, for example. If you do this all the way through your talk, you sort of become a metronome, and you're going to put people to sleep that way. So yeah, try not to do that. Practice with a mic. So it's a bit weird talking with a mic. So see if you know someone like Jaro or someone else who has a mic that you can just try out, get used to it. Especially someone who knows what they're doing to tell you the right place to put it on yourself. I've not taken my own advice here, but if you're talking, it's good to talk, wear a shirt or something with a collar, because it's much easier to find somewhere to clip a mic to. And this t-shirt is not too bad, but if you've got a really tight t-shirt up here, you're going to clip it somewhere on your neck and it's not going to get your voice. If you ever happen to speak with a handheld mic, I see this mistake so much, especially in the music industry, amazingly. It's all on tracks anyway, they don't really sing, do they? But they hold it in front of their mouth. And the thing is with covering your mouth is that the mouth is an important part of your communication. It's not just the audio. People need to be able to follow your lips, and they understand you a lot more if they can see your lips. So yeah, holding things in front of your mouth doesn't really help with that. Be passionate. Please be passionate, be enthusiastic. Talk about stuff that you are enthusiastic about. People love seeing that. Ultimately, people aren't going to remember what you said in your talk. They're not going to remember it word for word. But they will remember how you made them feel about what you were talking about. So if you're not doing this, then they're just going to remember that your talk made them quite bored or tired. But if you're really kind of up for what you're saying and you're really driving it through, then they're going to remember that they felt quite intrigued with what you were saying or motivated by it. Learn your talk. So thankfully I've done this talk a few times, I know it quite well. It's hard to motivate people by reading to them. I saw a very good talk at Redevelop in terms of content this year, but the guy basically just read his speaker notes to you, and he just spent the whole thing, he didn't engage with anyone, and it's hard to motivate people by reading to them, read his speaker notes. Yeah.
Sure. I'm a big Richard Dawkins fan, and I had a chance see him give a talk, and that's exactly what he did. Just for like 15-20 minutes, he was just reading a big chunk of one of his books that he was promoting, and it was so boring.
It doesn't matter how interesting the content is,
yeah.
You don't want to be read at, do you?
Yeah, because you see him on YouTube, and he's quite funny. Mm. You know, he can be quite engaging and humorous and spontaneous, but this was just so boring.
And we,
he could have been anyone.
Yeah.
And also the humanists, we've been to philosophy talks, and we're just keeping over. But
yeah. By the way, with any of my talks, this size audience, I'm quite happy for people to interject and stuff. If you're speaking to like a room full of 100 people, it's very rude of people interrupt because there's just so many people there, and they've got, especially if you're a conference, you're on a schedule, but something like this, please, let's make it conversational. I'm quite happy for that. Know the length of your talk. So this is genuinely in my talk, in my speaker notes, what the length of my talk is at this point in my talk. So it's not just about how long is your talk in total, but I put these little markers into my speaker notes so that I have an idea of where I should be at that point during the talk, so I know roughly whether I'm behind or whether I'm ahead from when I practiced it. It just makes me know whether I need to speed up or slow down to reach that end goal if you've got a time limit. And allow room for delays as well. When you say you've got an hour slot at a conference, and they say an hour plus, you know, that's got to fit in a bit of Q&A as well. But also, you've got to bear in mind that you might start 5 minutes late because of a technical problem. So at that point, you're then overrunning into the next talk. So always leave a bit of room, whatever the length of your talk is. Quit noisy programs. So Keynote's quite good in that it will do this for you automatically if you're using Keynote, but generally, it's just a good idea. Close down Slack, for example. Close down your emails, things like that. You don't want that popping up while you're giving a talk. Some slides can speak to themselves, so keep it brief. Take a glass of water, for example, if you've got a lot of text on your slides, which people can literally just read themselves, then you don't need to be talking 100% of the time. And sometimes you can over-explain your slides, like I'm doing now. So design your slides, build first, design later. So this is generally what my slides look like when I put this together. That's just a screenshot. Get the content right and get the flow sorted first, and then it will be easier to go in and just put the design in afterwards. Design is completely optional as well. You can make it pretty if you like, kind of like I've attempted to do here, or you can just do this. So this is, in fact, sometimes better because if you've got a projector or something, I'll go into this in a minute, but as Rich said earlier, you know, high contrast is going to be easier to read than the low contrast stuff. Just whatever you pick, just keep it consistent. Don't jump around styles. It can be quite jarring. So know the room. So visit it if you can. That's a really good tip. So I've spoken here before, so I've been here before, so I know exactly what the situation is. But ask for the technical specs if you're going to talk, especially at a conference. Find out whether it's a 4x3 or a 16x9 monitor, for example, so you know how to set your slides up, things like that. Is it a screen? Is it a projector? Those sort of questions. So yeah, projectors, high contrast is really important because stuff will show up like this otherwise. People won't be able to read. This is okay because I've used quite blocky text anyway, and it's quite large, so you can still see even though the contrast is crap. But if you had really thin text, for example, that would just disappear into the background. I'll look at this again when I come to code samples. Checking the sight lines. So if you've got raked seating, then it's not so much of a problem. If you've got flat seating like this, and you've got 8 rows back, for example, are people going to be able to see all of your slides? So, for example, I definitely can see this area, but both times I've given talks at conferences, I've gone and sat right at the back and imagined some people just slightly taller than me in front of me, and this whole area was completely, there's no way I would have seen it. So when designing your slides, think about that. I usually put this sort of stuff in the bottom. So, you know, if the stars align and people do get a quick glimpse at it, they can see this is just stuff that's consistently there throughout the talk, but the important stuff is up here. Go easy on the gimmicks. So metaphors are a great way to make things maybe more understandable, but don't do it to the point where the content gets lost. So say I use cakes as a metaphor, for example, as a metaphor for web development. So yeah, so I've got the, you know, this is the front end up here, the icing stuff, and, you know, the biscuit bases, what the sysadmins do and things. I could maybe take this further. I mean, what would candles be, for example? Any ideas? but what's the point I'm trying to make here? So analogies could be great, but at this point, am I using web design to explain cakes or cakes to explain web design? I don't know. High-res images make a lot of difference. So if you can, try and find a nice high-res version of the image. It just looks nicer. Create sections. So you notice I've created sections, titles. I put them in the bottom there because they're not really that important. But the actual talk itself is split into sections, and that means I'm jumping around a lot less. And so it's hopefully easier to follow. You can show your sections if you like. I don't think it's important. I just wanted to fill out the slides a bit. So when delivering the content, try and avoid assumptions. So try and say things in a positive way. Not everyone knows what you know, so try not to assume. These are really dangerous words. If I stood up here and I said, "We all use advanced custom fields," there might be someone there who's going, I have no idea what that is. I've never even heard of it. And by me saying, "We all know," you'll be sitting there going, "Everyone else in this room knows that, and I'm the odd one out. What's wrong with me?" So these are really dangerous to use. Don't be a dick. So, actually, just be sensitive. So I've used "don't be a dick" because that was in a talk I saw, and I was actually like, I get the point you're trying to make, but you could have said it in a nicer way. It's just about trying to find the positive way of trying to say what you're trying to say. A lot of talks can end up being, I realise this one has a lot of don'ts in it, but a lot of talks can be very negative and sound really down, kind of, you walk out of the talk at the end of it and you just feel rotten because you're like, oh, I didn't know all these things and I felt like the speaker was telling me off, when actually, just positive reinforcement. This is one of my favourite ones, so highlight with opacity. So this is okay. Because I can point at the screen, I'm level with the screen, it's quite small and everything. I wanted to point at something, you know, I can point at it. But you're not always going to have that liberty. Laser pointers are the worst. John Kinn did this a bit when I first saw him talk. He left his laser pointer on and he was just talking away. And it was just really distracting having this little light go around up here. But also they don't work on screens. So this is how I do it. So if I want to highlight Wally there, I've just used the design of the slide to highlight him. So now I don't have to point anywhere and you know what I'm talking about. Also only show what you need to. So I've gone for quite a busy image here, but it's actually this size. There's a lot going on here. And by trying to show you everything, I'm not really showing you anything. Are we all looking at the same thing right now? There's all sorts. If I zoom in, though, to the bit I want to show you about, so like here, I can show you, like there's Wally. And then I can move the image around. In this case, it's an image, but it could be a website, or it could be some code, for example. So I can move the image around to show you what I'm trying to show you. So I'm showing you Wally there, and then I might want to show you this human pyramid thing going on here, and then this guy on a donkey. And I wouldn't have been able to do that from far out. So this also works for websites, for example. So this actually exists, by the way. So I'm not showing the entirety of this Amazon web page. I could have taken this from further out and shown you the whole web page, but it means I'm controlling the content I want you to see, which means I can also use comic effect. For example, if we scroll down, oh yeah, so there again, I can use a highlighter to show you that it's only $3.99 for the hardcover here. But if I scroll down, you can also see there's a Where's Nigel and a Where's Boris available. in the frequently bought together. So people buy these a lot. So the thing without that is if I'd just shown you the whole page straight away, it would have been zoomed out. There'd be a lot of lots of things going on the page. You wouldn't all be looking at the same thing, but also I wouldn't have been able to then bring this in as a joke. Cool. Try and keep things in the slide deck. So I use this, for example. This is a tool for loading in websites within the slide deck. It only works if you've got Wi-Fi though, so use with care. But more to the point, if I've got a video, can I embed it in the slide and just play it in the slide? Instead of having to drop out of the slide deck and try and go into another application, because that can make it feel very disjointed for people watching. Obviously, if you're doing a live demo, for example, and you need to go to the command line and stuff, then do that. But there's things you can do there as well. Like Mike did a really good job with his, in that he had all that code actually in his talk instead of just trying to show us that in the files. So play animations once. So right now you're not listening to me, you're watching a cat on a Roomba. this is just really distracting. I haven't got your full attention right now because there's this going on. If I just played this once, it would have been a lot better. Don't leave your laptop unattended. I didn't add this, actually. Dave added this whilst I wasn't at my laptop at Beardsford Autumn. So, thanks, Dave. Good tip. Try experimenting with your delivery. So perhaps simply talking to people isn't the best way to deliver that content. I don't know why I put that picture in. I think it's just to show that, for example, you could give a talk. Or alternatively, this is a bar camp that I experimented with, a more of a workshop thing. So here I'm actually trying to demonstrate agile principles by getting people to build a train set to my requirements that I then kept changing. To just try and get across the things like focus on the priorities and things like that. So and it went down really well, actually. Just experiment with the format. It doesn't have to be a talk. Okay, so code samples in slides. I realize I'm overrunning a bit, sorry. So this is not your editor. If you take one thing away from this talk in putting together talks, is that you can't just take what is in your editor and put it onto a slide. It doesn't work like that. And as I say, Mike did a really good job with his. Avoid screenshots. So I've taken a screenshot of my editor here. There is a lot going on here, and if I was trying to explain this, it's all very tiny, and it's just a mess. I can't change anything as well. If this only wanted to update this, I didn't have to go and take another screenshot. So here's some code. I have seen slides that look like this, by the way, which is just terrifying. So I'm trying to talk about Twig, for example, here somewhere. I can't even remember where. So I'm going to use ellipsis to make this bigger, better. So unfortunately, I have not put this slide together very well in that it's been cut off by the screen, but there's some little dots here. Let me just see if I can move that across for you. There we go. So I'm using these dots that basically just show that there's other stuff in between these two blocks of code, but it's not relevant what they are. Using monospace font is really important, especially for things like slashes, for example. So if you don't know what a monospace font is, essentially every character is the same width. So if I go back to here, for example, there's things like the slash and other bits which they're just not as easy to see as when you use a monospace font. So that's where the editor is good. Breaking it down, so what I've done here is I've taken the first block of that code and then I've got the second block afterwards, so I can talk about this block and not kind of show too much at once. I'm giving you a wall of text and I'm talking about what's going on with this code up here, And then now what's going on down there? Syntax highlighting is cool. There are tools that can help you copy and paste from your editor into just whatever your slide deck is. And they usually, like PHP Storm, for example, you can copy straight into Keynote. It just seems to work, which is really nice. But still, this is not your editor, so this kind of code coloring stuff, this is PHP Storm's default one. It's great because it's low contrast, which means you could look at it all day and you're not going to strain your eyes too much. But you guys aren't looking at this all day. You're looking at it for like 20 seconds. So high contrast is much better. You wouldn't look at this all day. You'd hurt your eyes. But you guys can see this a lot clearer. This is actually the GitHub theme. So it should be quite familiar anyway. But it's a lot simpler. But yeah, you can see that on a projector. You can see it from the back. So highlighting as well. So there I just highlighted everything with color. You can use color to highlight just the bit of text you want to talk about. So I've grayed out that first line. So it's still there because it's relevant for context, but it's not the bit I'm trying to show right now in this code snippet. And then I grayed that out and brought in this bit down here, and I've used color there to focus the attention down there. Can I make this simpler though? So simple examples in here. I didn't need all this stuff about rendering and stuff, the point I'm trying to make. I'm actually just talking about how to do routing in Silex. So much simpler. Now, that's not production code. I wouldn't run that in production. But this isn't talk about how to do exactly everything like that would pass a code review. It's just trying to explain the basics. So here's a real example. The first time I gave my WordPress talk, this was a slide in it. And it's a screenshot from the editor. There's all sorts going on here. You don't know what I'm talking about. And this is now what it looks like. So it's the same, exactly the same code I'm talking about, but it's just a lot clearer what's going on, what I'm talking about, what file I'm in. I'm sure there's ways I could improve that as well if anyone's got any suggestions. So finishing the talk. If it's a long talk, go back over the key points. I haven't done this here because basically they're all key points, essentially. It's hard to pick out from that what the takeaways are, really. But if you do have big takeaways from your talk, it's great to remind people what they are at the end. Let people know that you're ending a talk as well. I see some talks, they just end very abruptly. And it kind of feels a bit odd. And people haven't really thought about questions yet. So right now, you know I'm coming to the end of my talk. So you might be starting to think about what questions you have to ask. Make feedback easy. So not everyone is happy dropping you a tweet, for example, or posting publicly onto some sort of feedback form. Some people might want to come up to you. So let them know that you'll be around for a few more minutes after the end of your talk. Or some people might want to do it anonymously. They might not want to approach you in person. So give them ways that they can do that so you can get feedback on it. So I will be obviously around after this. And if anyone does want to give me feedback, I am on Slack. Provide further reading. So Rostock has a really good blog on some more tips, particularly for getting ready to speak at a paid conference. There's some really good stuff in there. These slides are online, which I'll give the link at the end. Also, what's next? So Michael Heap is brilliant at stealing my ideas. And another one that he's stolen is at the end of my PHP South Coast talk, I put the talks which are on after mine on the screen so people didn't have to try and find on the lanyard what talk they wanted to go to next. It was just all up on the screen. But if you're not at a conference, so maybe what's coming up next at PHP Dorset or WordPress Bournemouth, wherever you are, I should have really asked these guys to find out what is next month so I could put that on the screen for you. And finally, say thank you. So thank you guys for listening. I realise that's quite a long talk. So, right, thanks. Any questions?
So it was Keynote you used, yeah, not PowerPoint?
Yes, so I used Keynote. I didn't like it at first, but then I really like it now, particularly because it does a lot of things to do with alignment. So if you Actually, let's do a demo.
Yes, please. I've never used it. I use PowerPoint.
So you did ninja that code across.
Yeah. I'm not going to be able to find the
what
TV again.
What looked to me was the picture moving on one slide. I've never seen that before. I didn't know you could do that.
The animation?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's jump into Keynote here. It's going to be really weird because it's just a slight delay between what I'm doing and what's on the screen. So first of all, I'll jump back to the Roomba because everyone loves that. Wherever that is, there is. So this is copy and pasting GIFs from the internet. It doesn't work. It just goes into the picture. But if you save it to your desktop, and then just drag it and drop it into here, it will go in as a movie. And you've got movie settings here, so you can trim it down, and you can if there's volume, you can have a volume as well, and you can tell it whether, for example, loop.
Yeah.
Or you can have none, which is what I recommend. So.
Yeah, sorry, that wasn't the one I meant.
Oh, sorry.
I think it was the Where's Wally one where you was.
Oh, moving around.
And then you kind of dragged it across.
Yes, sorry. Here we go. So, I believe it's this slide here. So I'm just going to get rid of. Oops. Actually, I will get rid of that. I'll get rid of my highlight as well. So that, by the way, is just it's just a circle that I've made that has a transparent center. So you see here it hasn't got a middle to it.
Okay.
And then it's just got a gradient on it. So it's ultimately just a really big circle. Illusion shattered.
Just using a donut on it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how I've been doing that. So this is... as part of the animate options here, you've got actions. I don't know whether it's actually on this slide. Yeah, it is in there. So what have I grabbed here? Oh, yeah, so you've got multiple actions. So if we go build order down here, it's got a move action. So actually, if I just go to something else. I'll just make something else move. So, add an effect, move. And then I can tell it where I want to move to and how fast I want to move there. And there's also easing options and things like that, which means that then when I play this, after my other things. Oh, unfortunately I've moved something that's actually hidden at the time. Let me go down to build order down here and get rid of that disappear. So you can make things appear and disappear and things like that. I'm actually going to get rid of all these. Remind me not to save this. So that should now move, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I haven't actually thought about moving my highlight, so that's quite a good thing to do as well. Other things I like about Keynote is, for example, getting these aligned was really easy because everything just, click on the right thing, it just sort of lines up with itself.
Oh, with that smart guides.
Yeah, so.
That's cool.
And also if I go to resize things, so let's think about somewhere I've got something of this. I haven't really got anything in here, like Dave's picture, for example. So to make things appear at the same time, I've just grouped them together and then given them an appear.
Yeah.
So if I've got two pictures of Dave, as I get to the same size, it will snap to the same size, so you can get everything the same size, and then you can do things like do like distribute objects and get them to distribute horizontally and things.
Yeah,
it just really helps you make nice slides.
PowerPoint does all that as well now.
It may well
do. It's taken them a while to because I'm a graphic designer, so obviously like Illustrator and stuff has been able to do that for 10 years. But like now you can do it with the PowerPoint and stuff.
Yeah.
It is helpful.
Yeah, so I found...
When you're trying to design a PowerPoint presentation in a way that most people, you know, to a degree that most people wouldn't bother because they're not graphic designers, but that's unfortunately the kind of stuff I have to do quite a lot.
It's good to have the tools that can
yeah.
to do it. I'm surprised how much PowerPoint lets you do.
It's really good now.
Yeah, I mean, just on the intro slides I put together, when I have the speaker name, I have the little sort of the avatar, it's a circle. I didn't realise, I thought I'd have to go into Photoshop to try and like get an image and then clip it to a circle. But you can actually have like a circle shape, put it on top, select them both. And
like
then
a
just,
mask.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, PowerPoint.
Yeah.
That, all
stuff like that is fairly recent, I think.
Yeah.
So I've got so frustrated with it in the past, where you're trying to just kind of line things up and do what you'd normally do in Adobe software, and you can't do any of those things normally.
Yeah.
Whereas they're kind
making horrible judgment calls.
So this is my talk that I gave at PHP UK, and you can see things like I've aligned all these up to be the same size and distributed and stuff like that. Just showing you how. This is my favourite effect that I just want to show off that I did.
Yeah.
So you can go as far as you want with it, really.
Yeah.
Obviously, you can over-animate things, but I've tried to use it where it helps illustrate the point that I'm making. I might have gone over the top. Yeah.
I think stuff like that is really helpful. You know, this visual stuff, it just really helps you get your point across, I think. Yeah.
Chris, when you did it at PHP Dorset, I think your last slide was your first slide, and you made a point of that. But
so, when I gave my this talk originally, I didn't know how to end it, so what I was doing was, my last slide was my first slide, and it's mainly because of the same reason why it's my first slide, is that it's just got a lot of information there, like there's a link to the slideshow and things like that. I actually meant to put this back at the end after the thank you, and I just messed up my formatting.
Oh, right, that wasn't a conscious decision to...
No, it wasn't. I would have gone back to this, or I would have done, as I say, what I did on this one, which was how I ended this talk, was again I had my customary thank you, and then I had this, which as I say had the slide they did the next talks on, but still has the information about how to contact me and things like that. So.
Yeah, that's a nice way to end it if you've got something on there.
Cool. If anyone wants to chat about putting a talk together or anything like that, I can always be found on Twitter or on the PHP Dorset Slack channel as well. I recommend doing it. It's, as I say, one of the best things I've done.
Okay. As soon as I know enough about something, I'll probably give it a go.
See,
finding something, like you say, not you know, don't want to be completely new to the topic, but finding something that you know enough about that you want to talk about, that you can get yourself up to a good enough standard to talk about it.
Yeah, I think also the mistake is with not wanting to give a talk is that you think you have to stand up and have the whole talk be stuff that people don't know. And actually, as long as there's maybe 10% of that talk which is new to someone, and what I mean by new as well isn't just it's a fact that they didn't know, it's a new take on something, a new way of looking at something, or a new opinion they hadn't heard about something. All that is new, and it just needs that little bit of newness for it to have been worth them going to see.
Yeah.
Even if the rest of it, they're like, I know that, I know that, I know that. A lot of people just like to be reassured that the stuff that they think they know is what other people know.
Is Keynote a good way of sharing it with other people and finding other topics you're interested in then as well?
Well, what I do with Keynote is I export it to PDF and then I put it on SlideShare, and then I can tweet it, I can put it on Slack, I can send it around.
Yeah.
And if you're very lucky, you know someone like Jarry who will record it for you. So. A small point on watching videos back. So I did this the first time the week before my talk. You will cringe Like, bring a pillow to hide behind is one of the most horrible things you can do, is watch your own talk back. But don't get too bogged down in that. Just focus on the pacing and the structure of the content. Like, did it make sense to go from that topic onto that topic? And am I going too fast or am I going too slow? They're the only things you need to worry about when you're watching your own talk back. Otherwise, you'll hate yourself. Yeah. And that's not a piece of advice that is me giving that advice. I mean, obviously, I'm giving it to you now. But I asked on Twitter. I said, hey, just got my own, a video of my own talk back. Do I watch it? You know, it's a week before the conference. And that was the advice I got back. And I took it, and it worked well for me. And that's why I'm sharing it with you. I actually had Jenny Wong at PHP UK come up to me. And I was talking about something with someone. I was far too happy to just say, you know, don't thank me at all. You know, I took this from somewhere else. I learned it from this. And Jenny Wong came up. She was a little drunk at the time. She we were all drinking, by the way. We were all in the pub. And she just had this amazing rant at me in a good way, where she's like, Chris, you need to take credit for this stuff, because you may have heard it from someone else, but you've chosen to present it in this way. You brought it to people's attention. So again, when it comes to giving talks, don't feel that you can't put other people's content up. You can totally do that. It's good to credit them where you can, but it's all part of the sharing. Yeah.
Cool. Thanks, Chris.
Well, thanks for listening.
Cheers.